Let's take a look at the monopoly market structure. By the end of this video, you should be able to confidently do two things. First, you should be able to explain the characteristics of a monopoly. Then we'll look at a monopolist diagram in both the short and long run. But before all that, let's establish what we mean by a monopoly. A pure monopoly is typically the first type of monopoly students have in their mind when they first learn of this topic. A pure monopoly exists when a firm controls 100% of a market. Although rare in practice, they do exist. We'll focus our discussion on pure monopolies and firms that are considered by the government to be monopolies. In a later video, we'll consider natural monopolies. A firm may be considered a monopoly by the UK government if it controls more than 25% of a market. This percentage may vary by country, but the value determined by the UK Competition and Markets Authority will be the basis of our discussion. A third type of monopoly we'll explore in the future is a natural monopoly. A natural monopoly exists when significant economies of scale exist by having only one firm in the industry. For now, we'll focus on the first two types mentioned, but we'll return to the natural monopoly in the next video. Let's look at five characteristics of a monopoly. First, as we've already established, there is one dominant seller. In this data from November 2013, Google controls 70.9% of the desktop search engine market share. This would allow Google to exert significant control over the search engine market. Second, the monopolist produces a unique product with no or few close substitutes. If you think of certain life-saving medicines that are one of a kind, you'll understand this characteristic. Third, there are high barriers to entry. These could be legal protections as seen here, such as patents, trademarks, or copyrights. They could also be advertising barriers for large firms which limit the ability of new firms to enter the market. Also, there are certain industries that require high levels of resources to be dedicated to research and development, which are out of reach for new firms looking to enter a market. Monopolists have price-making power because they offer unique products to consumers. This is a picture of Martin Shkreli, who ran a pharmaceutical company that raised the price of one of its vital medicines, Daraprim, from $13.50 to $750 overnight. The price of the medicine in the United States is now $800 per pill, and despite all the negative press they faced, the firm has maintained the drug's price as of the date of this video. Martin Shkreli was able to get away with this because there is no alternative medicine available and consumers had to purchase the drug to treat their unique diseases. For context, the price of this drug in the UK is about 66 cents a pill, and in Brazil it is about 2 cents. In fact, let me know if you agree or disagree with his actions in the comments. It's worth looking up his justification of this measure to understand his motives. Finally, due to this market power and protection from competition through high barriers to entry, the firm can maintain supernormal profits in both the short and long run. How the firm can use these profits will be analyzed later. Now that we understand the characteristics of a monopoly, let's draw the diagram. We first draw in a downward sloping demand curve or average revenue curve because a firm has price-making ability and would need to lower their prices to sell more of a product. Monopolies cannot charge any price they like, as consumers wouldn't necessarily always pay it. Second, the marginal revenue has twice the slope of the demand curve. Third, we add in a marginal cost curve, and finally the U-shaped average cost curve. To find the profit maximizing level of output, we need to find where marginal cost equals marginal revenue and drop down to the x-axis for the profit maximizing quantity, which is Q star. Next, we draw up to the demand curve to establish the price charged by the firm and take that across to the y-axis to label P star. Next, we find where that vertical dotted line crosses the average cost curve and draw across from there to establish our average cost per unit. It should be evident that the price we receive per unit is greater than our cost per unit at this quantity of production. The area for the total revenue for the firm is represented by the square shaded green. It is greater than our total costs, which are bordered on the right by Q star and above by the cost per unit. It should be obvious by now that our total revenue is greater than our total costs, which leads us to our supernormal profit. This blue region represents the supernormal profit earned by the monopolist in the short run and long run. The key thing to remember is that the high barriers to entry and market power of the monopolist prevent new firms from entering the market and eroding these supernormal profits. Firms can use these profits in a variety of ways. We'll consider that in a later video. You should feel much more confident in your understanding of the characteristics of monopoly, as well as your ability to analyze the monopolist diagram. If you have any questions, leave them below or email me at enhancedtuition@gmail.com. I'll do my best to reply. That's this one done, and I'll see you in the next one.